Brother Randy, do you have any announcements today?
Tarrying service this afternoon at 5 o'clock here at the church. Tarrying service at 5 o'clock this afternoon.
All right. And Brother Ed, Brother Roger, y'all might have to help me out here. If you haven't noticed, there's been quite a bit of work done at the church here. The ceilings all got sanded and painted, correct? I noticed all the wainscoting got touched up, caulked, looking nice. We got a new coat of paint, definitely outside, right? All the walls in here? And then you definitely couldn't have missed the floors out there. They look fantastic. So I don't know who all was involved. I saw Brother Calvin here a whole lot. Who else was involved in that? Well, it looks... Yeah, I came by several times and saw him here, so definitely thank you, Brother Calvin. We appreciate it. And everybody else that was involved, and I think it looks really good. So thank you very much. Got a couple birthdays this week. Happy birthday today to Sister Patty Glarner. Happy birthday. And the 25th is old Tori Lamberth. Happy birthday, Tori. Well, we have a special hello today. Brother Dale, if you could put that up. Everybody, hello to from Sister Gladys. Brother Mick, I believe this was her watching the service last Sunday. Is that correct? She's watching right now. Well, Sister Gladys, hello. We love you, and amen. We're thankful for you. Praise Yahweh Yahshua for you, and we are still praying for you, and think a lot about you. So hope you have a good day, and we're definitely good to see you, even if it's just on the screen here. And we've got one more there. So this is Brother Mick gave us this information. If you want to take this down, I'm sure she'd love to have a card, or I see your phone number up there, a phone call. Can she take visitors, Brother Mick? Can she take visitors? Okay. I probably should have asked that ahead of time, but yes. So if you want to take down that information, I'm sure she'd love to hear from every one of us. So we love you, Sister Gladys. It's good to have my brother-in-law, Jay, and his family here today, Emily and Audrey and Ava. Definitely thankful to have him here. I definitely hope they're able to be here with us again and again. I don't think I'm the only one. So let's all stand. As we pray today, let's definitely continue to remember Sister Patsy. I understand she has surgery, or supposed to have surgery this Wednesday. And Brother Allen sent a message. She had a hard time with her blood pressure last night. So let's definitely remember her. Let's continue to remember Sister Carolyn. Does anybody know she? I don't see Brother Rod. Or I know Sister Jennifer's out today. I don't know if she's still in the hospital. Anybody knows?
She's back there. She's
home.
Okay. Well, let's continue to remember Sister Carolyn. Also, Sister Gail. Is she still in the hospital? Okay. Let's definitely continue to remember Sister Gail. She's been through it with this. Let's ask Yahweh Yahshua to take this from her. Also, Brother Glenn. Brother Glenn's in a rehab facility, I believe. He's in the hospital. Okay, well, let's continue to remember Brother Glenn as well. Also, Brother Wade, Sister Gladys, and Sister Jennifer Suttle has been sick. So let's remember her as well. Are there any other special requests as we pray? For you and okay. Well, let's especially remember Sister Helen and also Sister Kathy, and let's remember Brother Ed and Sister Janie this week. Let's all pray. Everybody help me sing, How Great Is Our God. The splendor of a king, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. Trembles at his voice. Next, we'll have a couple songs by the choir. There was one other thing I was going to mention for our prayer. JoJo and Elijah's little brother should be here any minute now. So let's pray for Sister Kelsey and Brother Jesse. I usually say, I know this is a lot harder on the mom, but it's hard on the dad too. So let's pray for Brother Jesse as well. But very thankful for that family and all the work they do for Yahweh Yahshua and his work. So let's pray for them that everything goes smoothly. You'll be all right. Let's pray for Brother Roger and Sister Monika too. But let's pray that everything goes well and we get to see Noah really soon. Next, I'll sing a song, then we'll ask Brother Jess for a song, and then we'll turn the service to Brother Roger.
Have questioned him throughout the course of time. So many still reach out to him with broken hearts and minds. And if they'll follow in his plan, without exception, they will find Yahshua never fails. And even in the days of old, he brought his people through. And then he came to show his love, and he died for me and you. And then he rose again to prove that every promise had been true. Yahweh Yahshua never fails. Yahshua never fails. Yahweh Yahshua never fails. You might as well get thee behind me, Satan. You cannot prevail, because Yahshua never fails.
as your word throws down far away. I sing to you, and my heart cries, holy hallelujah, Father, you're near. My hope is in you, Lord, all the day long. I won't be shaken by trials.
good morning. Thank God to be together again. Thank God to sing glory and praises to his name. So good to have all of you here. Saints of God, I love him. I absolutely love the God that we serve. And through all the songs, I thought so much. How many times have you gone to him and cried out? And let me ask you, when you drew closer to God, has there ever been a time that he failed or did not move closer to you? I'm so thankful for those times. I love him so much. He is, and he came to establish a covenant to where, for all those who would come to him, they would find healing. Is that true? Healing in our lives, fixing the hurts, comforting. I praise God so much that we live in that covenant. Why don't we stand one more time together? And I wish that we would ask God a special prayer for understanding, for anointing his word. We've been on some of these things for quite some time. I feel like maybe today we're wrapping up this the studies we have had on the body and on the government and the order God put in the church. A beautiful subject when you break it down. And I pray that God will help us and give us all an understanding that it's just set in our hearts so well that we can, when we read Scripture, we will understand and be able to place it the way God intended for it to be placed in his church. So I wish we would pray for understanding and that he would anoint the word this morning. Let's pray. Dear Savior, we are going to bypass our review for this morning because, like I said, we're going to be on the same subject we have been on. And I feel like we're wrapping it up. And I don't want to, we don't have to do a review because we're going to do a review together. So, fellas, I sent something to you all. And I wish you guys could put it up on the screen. And let me see. Some of you guys mind. I've got some papers here. Why don't we go ahead and hand those out quickly? Just need about four of you. Maybe one person to take each section. Ben and Jennifer, why don't y'all jump in there and help? Well, Will was on his way. Yeah. Okay. Saved by the bell, Jan. Oh, I didn't see Brother Jeff was on the move over there. Thank you, Brother Jeff. I spent some time praying about this and thinking of a way that we could put it in a format that would be easy to see what God did for his church and how he set it up. This is something that will show. It's kind of hard to read up there. That's because it's a lot of stuff, some small print. So that's why it'd be good to have one in front of you. And I think we have plenty for everyone that would like one. And I might say that, this has the name of Yahweh Yahshua on it. So take care of it. Don't, I'd rather not see it laying around on the floor or something. Let's
Let's take care of this. Stick it in your Bible. Make notes on it as we go through some things. Use it as a reference to the government that God established in His kingdom. This is a very important subject because it is through the government that God established that the church functions without chaos and things being out of order and confusion. There are, as a matter of fact, I really don't know of another church. I hope there are, and I believe there probably are, but I don't personally know of another church that functions under this government that God set up in the church. And we've spoke with people on numerous occasions, and they were absolutely amazed that we have had over a 90, you know, this year is 90 years since the church started. From all calculations, it was 1933. I'm sure God was dealing with Brother Harden maybe a little earlier than that, but about 90 years it would be. That we've had three elders or three people that have served in the leadership position over all those years. That's amazing to so many. Because in so many situations over a period of 90 years, they've had, you know, just unbelievable numbers of people coming and going in those positions. And that's the reason there has been a stability in the Church of the Firstborn is because the church has gone to the Scripture specifically. And God has given understanding of how to establish the government or the order in the church. And so I want us to, we're going to start at the top. Obviously, you see Yahweh, Yahshua there. In the book of Ephesians chapter 4, and we'll get to that maybe here in just a minute. It speaks of Messiah, Yahweh Yahshua, being the head of the body. So in 1 Corinthians, let's begin at the top here in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, and we'll get verse 18. And like I said, this is I really worked to get it onto one sheet, something that you can make your notes on it and something you can go to and very quickly look down and see the order that God set in the church. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 18. In the NIV, but in fact, God has placed the parts in the body, every one of them, just as He wanted them to be. Or in the King James, as it hath pleased Him. I think that is a beautiful verse. How many of you agree with that? I want y'all, hey, you're the body, so I want you to get in here with me. We all make up this body. And God has placed the parts of the body exactly how He wanted it to be. Now, in Ephesians chapter 4, and verse 7 and 8, let's go ahead and turn there quickly, and we'll come back to Corinthians. We'll be back and forth between 1 Corinthians and Ephesians chapter 4 here. Ephesians chapter 4, verses 7 and 8, also in the NIV, but to each one of His grace has been given as Messiah apportioned it. Let's read it in the King James. But to every one of us is given grace according to the measure of the gift of Messiah. Grace, favor, God's Spirit. He has given the ability to each one of us in the gift to serve in the body, to serve His church, His purpose. The job of the body is to shine a light to the world. And so we are to use that gift. When I speak of the gift in the church, I'm referring to the job that the church has. And so something we've talked a lot about, and I think it's important for you to realize that God has given you a talent. God has given you a gift. We started this series of studies with the scripture about the talents that were given to the three individuals and how two of them put their talent to work. And God blessed that work. He blessed that work, and that talent grew and grew and grew as they moved closer to him. He blessed that work. And then we have the one example of the one who was afraid. And what did he do with the talent that was given to him by the master? He hid it, just buried it. And when the master came back, he took that talent from him and gave it to the one that he had given five and had doubled that. So God has given each one of us talents, and we know that. I've said this a few times now, don't let Satan beat on you and say you have nothing to offer or you don't have a talent to offer the body of Messiah, because that's a lie. God has given us talents. His call is to everyone. And what happens is when one answers that call, Yahweh Yahshua will put that talent to work. We've got to be willing, right? Come on, guys. We've got to be willing. But if we're willing, he's going to put that talent to work in his kingdom. And then we have to know that if we decide to bury it, or for whatever reason, maybe we don't use our talents for him, his purpose won't stop for that reason. God will accomplish his purpose. The question is whether we will use our talents that he has given us for his work and his purpose, or will he take that and give it to someone else to accomplish what his purpose is? He will. That's right. That's right. And the thing is, when we put his talents to work in his kingdom, he blesses you. Is that right? How many of you would amen that? He blesses you. And true. In true, he'll give you more. It's true. He will. He will use you for his work. He won't put more on you than you can handle. So don't use that. Don't let Satan tell you that either. Hey, I can't do this. Let's go just a little further here. He said, wherefore he saith, I'm still in the King James of verse 8, when he ascended up on high, he led captivity captive. He released all of us that were captive. Captive to what? To sin. To a life in this world. He came, he died, he made a way to have those sins forgiven. To free us from all of the things that this world will hold us captive or imprison us. And then he said, and he gave gifts to man. So he ascended, he freed us all. He freed those that were captive or shackled maybe in sin. He released that. He set us free. Serving God with all your heart, soul, and mind, he will set you free from the torment that Satan will torment you with. And when he led that captive, if you will, set his people free. And when he ascended, he left gifts for the church. Those gifts weren't just for that moment. They were gifts in the church. They were gifts to help the church for the generations. For how long? Till he comes back. And the church doesn't need those things. In 1 Corinthians chapter 13, the Apostle Paul talked about that and about how now remains hope. Is that right? Hope. And what did he tell us was the thing that would last forever? Love. And so these gifts are necessary as long as we are here in this world. And they are meant to help the body to shine the light. And so God set the members and he showered us with gifts. We all have gifts. We have something to offer. If we seek God, draw close to him, serve him with all your heart, soul, and mind, and then God will allow us to utilize the talents that he's given us. So you see the list here. We go from apostles, prophets, teachers, miracles, gifts of healing, helps, governments, and tongues. This is mentioned. Part of it is mentioned here in Ephesians. So while we're here, let's go ahead and grab that before we move on in verse 11. Messiah himself gave the apostles, prophets. Then he goes on to evangelists, pastors, and teachers. That's the third category of teachers, or those that help in the ministry. And he explains why he set these things in the church. He said to equip his people for works of service. This beginning thing here that he said, the apostles, the prophets, the teachers, these things were set to equip his people to use the talents and their gifts for the work of the body, for the work of the church. All the gifts are for the edifying of the body, but specifically Paul was speaking about the offices that he set, first apostle, secondarily prophet, and third teachers. And he goes on to speak about the importance of that, to build it so that the body of Messiah may be built up, verse 13, until we all reach unity in the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining the whole measure of the fullness of Messiah. And then in verse 14, I will just finish it up while we're here. Then we will no longer be infants tossed back and forth by the waves and blown here and there by every wind of teaching and by the cunning and craftiness of people and their deceitful scheming. So this order he mentioned, he said, is to equip the church to do its work. That's each member. And he said that we will not be infants, immature, spiritually he's talking about, tossed around by every wind of teaching and someone scheming. So what is he talking about here? Infants and all kinds of different teachers. So we wouldn't get caught up in that. These things were set to keep the church from entering into chaos. Can you all see that? For stability in the teaching, stability in the doctrine, the gospel, so that you're not easily swayed or tossed back and forth, but that you have stability, that your feet are planted on the rock and there's not confusion. Now, there are all sorts of orders that are set in churches. And many people in their own personal wisdom will say, I like that. I think that's a good order to set. But God's church is not left to us to try to decide what we think is the best government to establish in his kingdom. He did that himself. It's not up to us to try to come up with what we think would be a great way to govern the church or the work of the church. God did that. And I'll tell you right now, whatever he set is what we would be doing our best to follow. What do you all say to that? We're not set on a system of government because it's what we like. We're set on it because it's what the scripture teaches. And that's what will work in God's kingdom. See, our battle is not flesh and blood. If our battle was just in the carnal realm, then people can think, well, I think this will work. But our battle is spiritual. And we don't have the wisdom to establish a government on our own. We've got to look at what God set in the church. And this in Ephesus is a beginning. It's part of that. Paul taught the same thing at Ephesus as he taught at Corinth. But we're going to go back to Corinth in just a second here. Let's finish it up in verse 15 again. He said, instead speaking the truth in love. Speaking the truth in love. We will grow to become in every respect the mature body of him. Remember at the beginning, he has placed every one of them in the body. So what is, let me ask you, what does that mean? What's the body of Messiah? What is his body? We know naturally that flesh and blood suffered and died, was changed to a spiritual body. But what he is teaching us is that represented his church, that we are now the body, the church, the New Testament. And he placed them in the body. Now he's telling us how the body is to function. And so in love, he said, there's the key, because love is the Spirit of God. Is that right? The Spirit of God is not wishy-washy and anything goes. That's not the Spirit of God. But the Spirit of God is love and truth according to his word. And so the acts of the body have to be done in the love of God for the motives, the right motives to shine the light. He said, in every respect, a mature body of him who is the head, that is Messiah. So he is the head of this body, which means what? If he's the head of it, what does that mean? He's in charge. Praise God. How many of you are thankful that he is in charge? That's where you'll find stability. That's where you find stability. And when the church functions in this body the way he lined it up, it is peace, joy. What do you all say? Each member is able to do their job and utilize their talents to the fullest for his kingdom out of love. And tell me something about the love of God. Tell me something that you know about his love. What kind of fruits come from it? We touched on that Wednesday night. Tell me the fruits of the love of God. Peace and joy. Somebody else, that's good. About kindness? Is that it? Gentleness? Is the love of God self-seeking, arrogant, condescending? Saints, if a member in the body is doing that, then they will not be able to function and fulfill their place. Do you follow what I'm saying? But when the body is in tune to what God has asked us to do and how he's asked us to do it, then the body works beautifully and can become mature spiritually. In verse 16, he said, from him, the head, from Yahweh Yahshua, the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work. So he is the head, and the whole body is held together by him. He is the one. It comes down from him, and that's why he gave us his word. We have talents in the body. There are those that help hold peace together. What do you say to that? There are those that have a gift of prayer and they seek God for the saints. There are so many precious gifts and helps, and everyone has a talent to fulfill something, their place, their part. And so let's go back to 1 Corinthians. We'll jump over to the congregation side here in just a second. But let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 28. This is an important scripture, and this is where this order comes from, because here Paul at Corinth, he went further than just the first three spots that he set. Sorry for the water, my allergies. I'll lose my voice if I don't wet my whistle every little bit. So 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 28. We've been over this a few times, but I want you to see why it's listed the way it's listed. Let's grab verse 27. Now you are the body of Messiah. Each one of you is a part of it. Here Paul is writing to the church at Corinth, and we'll get into something here in just a minute, that Corinth was out of order, and they had a lot of chaos. And Paul was putting a stop to the chaos. It was his job to do that. He was the apostle. And he wasn't one of the original 12, but God had a work with the Gentiles. He called Paul. Paul was an apostle, and he was over works and churches there. And he wrote letters to those churches. Later, when Paul was older, he was working with some younger men and telling them what their job would be as they became the leader of those works or different works. And so he starts by telling them, listen, you are part of the body. Every one of you, each one, you're all a part of it. And then he goes to set some order. Verse 28, God has placed in the church, first of all, apostles. So he let them know in this body that we're all a part of it. We use Scripture Wednesday, there are no big I's and little U's. That's not God's way. We are just all part of the body, and God has called us to do different works. But there has to be an office that is responsible for keeping order. Do you all follow what I'm saying? And so how did God do that? Many people have a committee that are the final authority or the as high up as you can go in the church to keep order. Now we know God is the head. We don't question that. But what did he set for his people, for the church? Some will have a committee. If that were the case, this would read, first, he set a committee. And then second, he set whatever. It's not what God said. Many churches, the congregation is the final say. We talked a little bit about that Wednesday night. Brother Danny shared with us the church that he went to was similar to that. And you had what they called Black Sunday when they would vote their preachers in and out. And then they had a committee who searched for their new one. God did not say, I have set in the body first the congregation. We're all the congregation, aren't we? Every job that you see up there or have on your sheet, apostles, prophets, teachers, miracles, gifts of healing, helps, governments, gifts of tongues, all of those come from the congregation, the body of Messiah. We all make that up. And then he compared us in another script. Well, in this chapter here in 12, he compared us to a body as each member of the body does its part. And so what he says here, he had first set the office of apostleship. On your sheet, it says the meaning. It has the meaning of apostle, an ambassador. Well, an ambassador of who? Huh? The president of the United States sends an ambassador over to a place to represent who? To represent the president, the administration in our government in the United States. But Yahweh Yahshua also has an ambassador. And it's also said he that is sent. That's another meaning of the word. If you look it up in a Greek dictionary. Unfortunately, we don't have the original Hebrew or Aramaic, but I'm sure that translation is accurate into the Greek. We looked that up. That word means ambassador or one that is sent. Well, that is one that is sent for a particular job. And we talk about that down below here a little bit where I break it down. But let's go through the verse first, and then we might jump down and read the little print at the bottom of your sheet. Has placed in the church, first of all, apostles. Second, prophets. Third, teachers. He said, then miracles. Then gifts of healing. He kind of put the rest of these together. Then gifts of healings, of helping, of guidance, of different kinds of tongues. And then he goes on to say, are all apostles, are all prophets, are all teachers, do all work miracles, do all have gifts of healing, do all speak in tongues, do all interpret? Now he's talking about the desire for greater gifts. But we have to understand that. People can misunderstand that. If we have a carnal desire, it would be self-serving. What does our desire have to be with the talents God has given you? Service, to serve Him, to bring glory to His name. And as we use those talents to the fullest potential, and we are doing that to bring glory and honor to Him, not selfish, not self, but to Him, God will bless you. And as you take care of the gift He gave you, just as the parable spoke, He will multiply that and He will give you something else to do in His kingdom. He will utilize you. So when I ask the question, I've asked this many times, how many of you want to be a vessel that our God can depend on? That He knows where you're at with Him. And He knows you're ready and prepared, a vessel ready to do His work. You all want to be that? Then we've got to be ready. Is that right? Because when Yahweh Yahshua has a particular job or something He wants done, if you're that vessel, He's going to call on you to do it. If it is to witness His truth to somebody, He's going to put you in a spot and give you that opportunity. We have to be a vessel ready. And then He goes on to speak the beautiful chapter about love. If you do great things, but it's not love, not for the right reasons, then it has no impact. It's of no avail. It doesn't add anything to your record. And He speaks about love then. And so the order we just read there is on this sheet. And I want to just, well, I tell you, before we do that, let's cover congregation. Let's cover the congregation. If you notice the brackets, all of these gifts, they come from the congregation. This is God's way. We've talked a little bit about this, but there are different types of churches. There are churches that, as we've studied in great depth, the Catholic Church and in the fourth kingdom on earth, the Roman Empire, which Daniel called a beast and John called a beast. When Catholicism was working under Constantine in 325 A.D., to become the empire's state religion enforced by the government, they established a government in the church, in the Catholic Church. How did they go about doing that? How many of you know, remember, we've had many studies on it. How many of you remember, how did they go about? How did Constantine direct them to set up the church government for the Catholic Church? Paralleled to the secular government of the Roman Empire. Man's wisdom. Well, the Roman Empire government worked pretty good, didn't it? It kept the largest empire known intact for centuries. It split eventually, but still the power of that empire went on and on and on. It was 1500 before people could break out of that Catholic Church and live to tell about it. So it was a government that was established according to the secular government. And they had a hierarchy, many levels of a hierarchy. And some have tried to convince people that that's the kind of government we set up in the church, where there is a body that anoints the ministry and sends them like a hierarchical church. And it's one of the biggest lies that have ever been spread about the Church of the Firstborn. We are obviously an independent church that is based on the scriptural government. It's not based on man's wisdom. It comes from this very scripture, and it's the exact example that we find in the Bible. We have bylaws. It's the Word of God. Is that right? And every office, every position that is in the church government. Where does it come from? It's identified in the scripture. And who fills those positions? Come on, who fills them? Good and loud. I know God sets them, but where does he draw the people to fill those positions from? The body, the congregation. Every single office is filled by people in the congregation, in the kingdom, in the body. And so when we look at this about the congregation, 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 27. We already read it, but we'll go ahead and read it again. Now you are the body of Messiah, and each one of you is a part of it. He didn't leave people out. If you're in the church, born again, right? Nicodemus asked, how do you get in the kingdom? Yahshua said, you got to be born again of the water and of the spirit. And then after the death and resurrection, the death of the testator, ushered in the new covenant. Peter did the first preaching at Pentecost after that. In Acts 2:37, the people believed. And then Peter told them what to do because they asked, men and brethren, what do we have to do? And Peter said, repent, turn away from sin. You know, clean your life up. It's not hard. Just try to live by God's word. He said, and then be baptized, every one of you. How? In the name. And what for? The forgiveness of sin. And you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Born of the water, born of the Spirit. Born into the church. Born a child. Spiritually, a newborn babe. Into a new kingdom. A spiritual kingdom. And then you are placed in the body. And then God begins to work with those talents you have that he gave you. To do what? To fulfill your purpose in the body. To do your part, to do your work. And so he said, every one of you are a part of it.
Brother Rogers, it's safe to say that each and every one of God's people are an ambassador to Yahweh.
That is true.
They have a job.
That is true.
Each and every one of us are an ambassador.
That is true, yeah. We all have a job to represent his body. And so in Ephesians chapter 4, 15 and 16, we've already read that, but the point here was made that in verse 15 is that Yahweh Yahshua is the head of the body. And then in verse 16, from him the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work. That's how the body functions. And when it's like that, it is beautiful. It works beautiful. And from that comes great peace and joy and worship and communion. How many of you feel that? So let's go down to the footnotes here, or the descriptions of each one of these jobs. And the reason I put this in, I don't go into great detail describing each job. We can do that, but I wouldn't have been able to get it all on one page. I think we all know a prophet is one that foretells, prophecy, the gift of prophecy. We know that. Teachers, we know they help with the ministry. Miracles, we know, is a spiritual gift that has power, the power of God behind that. Gifts of healing, we understand that. We've seen that many times. We've seen the power of God many times. We've seen healing many times in the church. I think when our faith grows, we'll see more and more of it. When the body is drawing close to him and the members are utilizing their talents and that faith is growing, then the body, you see more and more of the spiritual gifts at work. We've got helps. We know different kinds of helps, governments, different tasks that are given out, and gifts of tongues. And so what I've done on the bottom here is something that is always the question about church government. And it would be, how do you keep the order? So in a government, it is always established. For instance, what I said, the Catholic Church, they set up a hierarchy all because of all the provinces. They did it just like a mere image, and historians call it an image of the secular government. And they had a hierarchy of who answered to, who had power to remove or set if somebody had gone rogue and whatever. a structure in the government that has the authority to keep the chaos. Or when there's a disagreement, how does that work? And so, again, it starts with apostles. And I don't get these things just, these are based on the scriptures. And we'll hit a few more scriptures to back it up, but we don't have time today to hit all of them. But every bit of this is completely backed up by the Word of God. And we can look at how the early church functioned in this new covenant, and we can see, well, if we implement these offices and we follow this structure, then we would function exactly like they functioned as they established churches and wrote letters to the churches. And so apostle or apostleship, the office of apostleship, we often call it, and the apostle John referenced himself as the elder. There are elders, but John referenced himself as the elder because he was an apostle over certain works. And he was writing letters to the church. So we often say elder. We prefer just brother. What do you all say to that? It's what we've always done as a church is just brother. And we leave the titles aside. But the apostleship, and I put up there, it's the office of leadership. So God sets a man to serve in the office of apostleship. I don't make any apologies for this. I've been questioned before, who sets the apostle? Well, God does. And I've been questioned by, I said, well, how do you remove apostle that has gone rogue? Well, look in the scripture. I didn't say first apostles, that's God's word. Is that right? And so how do you remove an apostle? We know that it's one that is sent, an ambassador that God has sent. So where's our example of an apostle that went rogue? We've got one in the scripture, Judas. Is that right? And the scripture does not say that there was a committee that decided he had gone rogue. No, God is the head, and he appointed an office of leadership in the church, and he handled that. Am I telling you the truth? When Judas went rogue and made a mess, and started acting in a selfish way rather than for the work of God, God removed him. And that's how it works. Now, obviously, in these bodies, we have a number of days. When Paul faced death, it wasn't God removing him for some wrong reason. Paul served God to the very end, as Brother Harden did and Brother Bob did. But in this life, we have a certain number of days. But when Brother Harden passed, did the government of God stop? Of course not. Why? Because Yahweh Yash was the head of it, right? And so what did he do? He called another man. And so God called Brother Bob to that office. But how was Brother Bob able to use the gift that God gave him in that office for the benefit of the congregation? Well, the congregation had to come to the place that they believed in faith and knew that God had placed him. Do you understand what I'm saying? That's why we're the body. The congregation has to feel, yes, God has called that person. So how do you know? Well, I can tell you, I sat under Brother Bob's teaching, and I could feel the power of the Spirit as he was teaching the Word of God. How many of you can say amen to that? I saw the power of God when we prayed for the sick. I saw God using him in that capacity. And as we saw God work that way and him fight those who rose up against that government, God's people, the body, became confident that God had set that man in that office. It's the only way that he would be able to have the effect on the congregation that God intends on that office having. Do you all understand what I'm saying? When Brother Bob passed, does that mean, as some have tried to convince people, that, boom, it was over, the government was done, and just go down the list and find whoever it is that says, I'm in charge now, and let them be in charge? Can you imagine that? Could you imagine that? What do you think? God established a government. And when Brother Bob passed away, I had a job to do. I was appointed behind the pulpit by Brother Bob, or ordained. But Brother Bob could not appoint me to the office of apostleship. Do Do you understand that? Why? Because you don't see a parallel line from apostle that say, now from now on, each apostle is in charge of appointing the next leader. No, the apostleship comes from who? God set first apostle. You see what I'm saying? So that office of leadership has to be by God. We have a recorded tape of Brother Bob saying, Brother Harden did not give me this job of leadership. Now, Brother Harden did ordain him and appoint him to teach, to preach in the office of a teacher. Is that right? And he was carrying out that work. But when Brother Harden had passed, Brother Bob filled the office of apostleship, and he made it very clear in many services. We have a recording of one where he said, Brother Harden did not give me this job of leadership. God did that. And I've studied that. I know we all have studied that. And it all fits and connects with the Word of God exactly how he intended on being. And as time goes on, if time goes on and he doesn't come back first, my generation will reach our end of days at some point. And when I pass away, God will not leave this office unattended. How would he do? Why would he do that? Our God would leave his people, his sheep, without leadership? What would that cause? It caused chaos. And those who refused to recognize that God appoints that position, they left the church and they've been in total chaos ever since. And have split among splits among splits among splits. And total chaos. God would never do that to his church. And so he set someone in that office. But saints of God, it's just God's government. And we all have a job to do, and we are held accountable to him to do that job. And so, yes. Well, that's, Brother Dave, wouldn't that cause total chaos? If somebody that... That's true. We have had, over our history, Brother Harden has had, Brother Bob has had. Praise God, we haven't had this one. I praise God for that. Well, I guess maybe we did right at the beginning. But have teachers that have rose up, right, in the past, and they... wanted what Brother Dave said. They would tell Brother Harden or Brother Bob, I got more light. I need to take your position. But why was it that Brother Harden and Brother Bob were able to hold that position? God gave it to them, and the congregation recognized the order that God set. His sheep heard his voice, and they would not be a participant in that chaos because they understand the word. And in our time, we had some way down there in that government's thing that they had been appointed to do a job. And at the beginning of this, we had someone that was teaching in Hartsville that went rogue as well and ended up losing understanding in the name of God. And so did these others in government that were given jobs as deacons. They rose up, hey, we're in charge because Brother Bob died and he didn't appoint somebody. Brother Bob and myself, Brother Harden, can only appoint somebody into the office of teaching. Is that right? Or another office of governments or help, but cannot appoint the office of apostleship. Now, they may recognize that if the Holy Spirit has called through prophetic message, which we have had in every case, including Brother Harden. In every case, we have had that. In Brother Bob's case, Brother Harden had the stroke and lived for 7 years. And through prophecy, Brother Bob stepped into that position while he was sick. But when Brother Harden knew through prophetic message that God had called Brother Bob, and he acknowledged that. Is that true? Brother Bob, he made comments among the congregation. Is that true? That would lead you to see what he's doing. He took moves in front of the congregation when he appointed me here while he was alive. Is that true? And why he came to church, just like Brother Harden and Brother Bob. Brother Harden was at church, but he had Brother Bob teaching. Did we witness the same thing? We did. And Brother Bob passed, and the God had dealt a few times before then, but he dealt very clearly in the congregation right after that. But what had to happen, even though it was through prophetic message as well, what had to happen in order for me to function in that office? The congregation had to know it. I remember Sister Teresa. Good old Sister Teresa. She's a wonderful soldier. She told me I had to know for myself. And that's a true statement. And I appreciate that. That's an honest statement. And that's how it is. In the body, we share the Spirit. We're placed in the body by the Spirit of God. But we have to know for ourselves. We have to realize when we look at the order God set in the church, you have to know that that's what he set. And so he goes on to say, and I think this is very important, an apostle is to lead the church. But listen how an apostle is to lead the church. Using the scripture to guide and direct in all matters. Is that right? That's where it's at. And it's not complicated. As somebody in that office is leading, they're not going to go off on a tangent about all their own thoughts. It's going to be backed up by this word of God. And the body, and as we always recommend and encourage to bring your Bible, to read the scripture, to study the actions that are taken, even concerning dealing with all the people in the body, are based on the word of God. It has to be. What do you all say to that? It has to be. And he goes on then and says the apostle is charged to be the overseer of God's work. And that's an absolute fact. When the body is functioning like it's supposed to, it's very easy. We all just work together and we move forward. But in the direction, I remember we've studied old Bible studies that are tape recorded in the 80s, in the 90s, in the 2000s, where Brother Bob taught lessons where some of the deacons that left the church were challenging, saying, he's in charge of spiritual, we're in charge of the land. And there could not be anything further from God's work and the truth. That is a lie. And Brother Bob taught it over and over and over. Brother Hardin taught it. And here's the thing. People are appointed to do jobs. And saints of God, I thank God that I can just leave them alone, let them do their job. But when it comes time for direction and God starts dealing in a direction that the church might be taking, whether it's building a school, well, where did that leadership come from? He dealt with Brother Hardin years ago, then dealt with Brother Bob, and Brother Bob started the work. Whether it's building a retirement home, God will deal, and then the person that is in that leadership office has got to work with the people that are willing to use their talents for God's work. And then we move forward to start a work or a direction. That is the overseer's job. Can you understand what I'm saying? But then that work is often delegated. Is that right? People are called. Why? Because God has given them talents. Is that true? Why did Brother Bob lean on Brother Larry to build the school building? That's a massive building because God had given him talents in that area. Is that right? And he knew he would work with him and would respect that. And he did. And so that's how that part works. And to keep order in the church, which includes the removal, if necessary, of any individual serving any position. So this is something that people struggle with. But once the church is established, and then people are in the body as God has placed them in the body, and they're doing their work. That's a beautiful thing, and things are going well. But now what if somebody is doing a work and maybe they go into sin, they leave the body, they're doing things contrary to the word of God. Now what? If God did not set someone to deal with that, then you would have chaos in the church. Is that right? You would simply have chaos in the church. So who would be responsible for that? Well, we can look in the Word of God. We're not going to have time, but we might not be done with this. I thought we would be. But we can look at scriptures to see where the Apostle Paul did that, where the churches dealt with certain things. Paul gave them their worship service in Corinth in chapter 11, was all out of order. Things were going in total chaos. He said, this is why some of you are weak and sick. And then he told them, gave them some instruction, and he said, the rest I'll set in order when I come. Do you follow what I'm saying? So the Apostle Paul was responsible to keep order in that church. And when that church got out of order, it was his job to work through that. And praise God, we don't have that issue. I'm so thankful for that. But there are times, there will be times when something has to be dealt with, and somebody has to do that. And God put that position in apostleship. It is no surprise that it would be the person that's responsible for teaching the word. Is that a surprise to you? So that God gives them understanding, a depth of understanding of that, so they can use that word to make sure that the body doesn't become sick, as Paul mentioned in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. They became sick because the body got out of order. The word of God will set that, and many times that's what does happen, Brother Dave. So let's go through the rest of these quick. Prophet. One will serve the church in this office when recognized by the leadership to have the spiritual gift of prophecy. So we could talk a lot about the spiritual gift of prophecy. We can go to examples. But this section is to show the order. And Silas was a prophet. Guess who Silas helped in the ministry? And who chose who? Who chose who? Paul chose Silas. Paul chose Silas. And in the body, God gives that spiritual gift. But what would happen if we just said that's up to each individual to decide whether God gave them that gift? There would be total chaos. And that was happening at Corinth. There would be total chaos. Maybe somebody, God is given that gift, but their years of serving God, maybe there needs to be more understanding. And there's no doubt there is a lengthy time of proving when God is dealing with somebody in prophecy. That's happened in the church. It does happen. It's something that's very common. But to reach that position of the prophet in the church, then the person that is set in the leadership position has to know that person is in that office. Do you follow what I'm saying? Otherwise, in the body, there would be false prophets jumping up all over, and there would be no one to say, hold on, you are out of order. And you would have chaos, and that's what they had. So when I go down through these spiritual gifts, and we won't read all of them until we get down to helps, but miracles, gifts of healing, prophets, gifts of tongue, those are spiritual gifts given by God. All of it is a talent given by God, but these are specific gifts given by God. But in order for those gifts to function openly in the church and there not be chaos, then the person in the office of apostle has to recognize that person has that gift. There are people in the church that have gifts of tongues. And I've talked to some that when I prayed about that, I knew that was a private gift. Doesn't mean that someday it wouldn't be a gift that is used in the church. But at least for the moment, I've told some, I believe that's a private gift. And there's room for that in tongues. It's completely by the scripture. But when that tongue is spoken out loud in the congregation, what has to come after that? An interpretation. Now you're into something that is in the church that could cause chaos. So obviously somebody has to say, hold on, there's an order. Corinth had chaos. They had people jumping up speaking in tongues all over the church. And Paul cleared that up and he said, three at the most in a service. And even at that, what is it? One at a time. That's order. And who has to keep that order? Obviously it would be my job if we had that. And I want you to understand something. If we had that happening in the church and I let that go, what do you think? These are things that are heavy responsibilities because God will hold you accountable. If I were to allow the church to become the body chaos and cause people to lose out and get discouraged. That order has to be kept. I promise I'm going to go through these quickly now. Let's jump down to teachers, because I think this is an important gift. It's third on the list, those that help with the ministry. And I put in here one who assists in the ministry, specifically teaching the word, will serve through appointment. And that's how it is. And when you read the scripture, when one was preaching, they were appointed to do that. Apollos at Corinth, different ones were appointed. And that's how we have it here. Our teachers or helpers, they are appointed by the person that's leading. Otherwise, you would have everybody saying, I am the teacher of the word. And it would be chaos. Maybe someone has that gift. Maybe they don't. And you would have chaos. So that's an office that is appointed. Gifts of helps. Jump down to number six. Those who are recognized or appointed. There are helps in the church. This is where majority of the church, not all of us at some time, this is where we've served in the body. Sometimes those are spiritual gifts that are used in building and edifying. Sometimes those are jobs that are appointed by leadership to do a certain project or to help with something, a work of some kind. And so the leadership must recognize that, of course, or again, you would have chaos. You'd have somebody saying, I've decided I'm going to go over here and build a building, and I can do that. Someone else says, no, I'm a better builder than you. I'm going to build one beside it. You'd have total chaos. The church couldn't function like that. God's will and his purpose would not go forward if we were all just out doing whatever. There has to be an order to that, an appointment or recognition. And I'm going to end it here with governments, because I already covered the gifts of tongues. Those appointed by leadership to carry out a particular task or responsibility. For instance, a deacon board, a school board. We could go on with several things here. The campground committee, maybe the AV department. We can go on with several things here. But this is a group of governments or administrations. At one time it was translated. The NIV calls it guidances. But these are positions, as was done in Acts chapter 6. They had a particular task that was overwhelming, feeding the widows. And so the apostles said, choose out seven men. So the congregation had a part in acknowledging these are seven good men. And then what happened, the apostles, what did they do? They appointed them over that business, that particular task. Now, that task could have changed over the years, but the record is they were appointed over that task. And so these things are, these positions and administrations, they're giving an assignment or a task to handle, and that is an appointment. Is that right? Anyone have a question? Anyone have a question? Yes. No. Amen. It is a responsibility, Brother Tim. And the thing is that Yahweh Yahshua is the head, and we have to please him with what we do. Is that right? It has to. Throughout the church, Yahweh Yahshua knows the talents, and then he gives the grace, the ability to do that. So you're right, Brother Tim. It is critical that people are placed where Yahweh Yahshua has placed them. Is that true? It is so true. And I praise God that we have such wonderful peace, that the body is functioning so well. That's why we see so many things happening. When Satan is throwing the darts and trying to stop the work, because the body is functioning. The body, we're seeking the Yahweh Yahshua to use our talents. And what is he doing? On paper, he'd say, hey, no way. They might as well find a rock to crawl under. But God just keeps blessing, and it's moving. It's moving at such a pace, you know what? The body better not be sick, or we won't be able to keep up. Is that right? We certainly wouldn't be able to do the job. And so I praise God for blessing his people with so many talents And I praise God that his people are serious about using their talents for him and for the right reasons. And in that, God just continues to bless the church. Let's all stand. Anyone else have a comment? I'm sorry for going over. I really wanted some testimonies. I'm not even going to say we might finish this up Wednesday. We may be done. We may be done with it. I don't know. I'll pray about that and certainly want us to study whatever Yahweh Yahshua wants us to study. Anyone else have a comment or a question, a thought? Yeah. That's right.
You don't just sit in the congregation and stay quiet. You
right.
You have to sit here and float through. You have a part. You have a work to do. I'm thankful for that. It locks us in.
Amen. Amen. And we have the example of Asia Minor that left. They left who? They left the Apostle Paul. So what do you think happened in those churches that left the apostle, the one that God set? What do you think happened to him? Chaos set in. Later on, history says that entire area was completely studded with Catholic churches, Roman churches, completely studded with it, with Roman churches. While God's people, the Hebrews and those of the followers of the apostles were being persecuted mercilessly and in the wilderness, those churches left the Apostle Paul and they went out on their own. And that is an example. The congregation plays a very important part of that. Very important that we study the word, and as Sister Teresa said, that we know for ourselves. And I hope that this sheet will help you. Will be something, a quick look and a study. And we have many other verses you can jot down that we've been over. Maybe look at your notes and transpose some of those things over to this sheet. Anyone else have a quick comment or question? Amen. Thank you, Yahweh.
Safety and freedom of growing up where his church is in order. We know where to go. His
Amen.
Leads. I remember when things would happen, and I would look at our leader's face. I looked at Granddaddy. I looked at you. When something was going on, I looked at your face.
Thank you, Yahweh.
And I could see how Yahweh Yahshua is leading.
Thank you,
Yahweh
Yahshua. Thank you, Yahweh Yahshua.
Thank you, all my life, this has been faithful and true. I love you.
Amen.
I know you didn't ask for testimony, but it was stirring.
Thank you, Yahweh. Bless your master.
I praise him. I am 43, and I have seen two leaders in the church.
Bless your master.
Brother Harden passed away when I was very, very young. I didn't get sleep to sit under his teaching.
Thank you,
Yahweh. His peace has always prevailed through his government.
Thank you, master.
Praise him.
Amen. I thank God for that too. You reminded me of something. I'm going to let you go. I promise. Y'all are hungry, aren't you? I remember when you brought back a memory there. I think I may have mentioned it, but one jumped up claiming to be a prophet, I guess, because that's what they were doing. And they were screaming, no, 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 and just shaking that finger at Brother Bob because he called her mama out because she did something she shouldn't have done. And he called her out, and they weren't going to have any part of it. And she came down shaking that finger, saying, in the church, as though it was that she was a prophet and as a spirit of God. And I love how Brother Bob responded to that. When they started saying that God rebuked him, do you remember that? A certain group, you see, it started way before Brother Bob passed, this rebellious activity. And what did Brother Bob say? He said, show me in the word where I erred. I love that. And that's right. He was put in that position, and he knew exactly how to handle that. Because what happened? If it was the Spirit of God, what would it do? It would agree with this. It would agree with this. And they couldn't. Do you remember how silent they were about that? They couldn't answer that question. Praise God for his word and the stability that the word and the spirit must agree. I thank God for everything he's done. Brother Tim, when you were talking, we've got a king, don't we? His name is Yahweh Yahshua. And I praise God that we are his subjects. I'm so thankful for that. Are there any special requests? my goodness. You know, when we talk about the word of God, it just seems like time flies. Maybe not to you guys, but it does seem that way to me. And I was really hoping to get to a couple more verses. But appreciate all of you being here. I love you. I hope you'll come back again very soon. And in the meantime, let's pray. Let's pray for each other. Let's pray for the body. Let's pray for those who need God in their lives, the healing that comes from serving him. Let's pray that he will help us shine his marvelous light. Let's all pray. Dear Savior.